It's underrated because, as someone said, that patriotism is the last refuge of a scoundrel. I own flags. I treat them with respect. They never touch the ground. But what they protect, what they symbolize, is our country, whose First Amendment to the Constitution is freedom of speech. And so if that's what you want to do, I would not do it. That is why I respect and I revere and I love that flag. I've got a gigantic flag that's 9 feet by about 25 feet that was deaccessioned from a Colorado Rocky Mountain Historical Society. And I hang it from the second story porch of my lake house every 4th of July. It is the symbol of our country. It makes me feel good to look at it. And yet I will defend to the end anyone's use of it. What matters are the ideas, not the false patriotism. And I can understand, too, why somebody who is a veteran and feels that this is desecration, it is. But I have to say to them, it is not. The only desecration is by the people who manipulate the Constitution. That's the danger. I'm sort of neutral on it. I like the obvious ones. I think it's super important that documentaries be made fun of and ridiculed in really important ways. And my understanding of mockumentary extends to these classic takedowns of my work, you know, 1,000 of them, you know, on The Simpsons, on Jay Leno, on all, you know, being made fun of is just the best thing because it keeps you from taking yourself too seriously, which is the great danger that absolutely everyone falls prey to. At a time, they were underrated for me. I sort of think, for me personally, I've got to say overrated. I'm done. Oh, I've had some wonderful times. I remember once on mescaline, I got off work and we were heading to a park. I got there at like noon and I said, man, I told my dad I'd be back by 8. I got to go home. And they said, it's 12:35. Over. I mean, the English language is one of the great forces on earth. And now it's down to, you know, abbreviations. And that's a terrible thing to waste. I wanted to start something that was the answer to Twitter. And it would be 1,400 characters before it would actually leave. Like, you actually had to craft language before you could even press send. It couldn't be under 1,400 characters. Yes, okay, it is so underrated. I feel happy, I feel joyous. I feel like there's the cavalry's come over the top of the hill to help us deal with the current trouble. I've spent the last 8 years working on a history of country music, and people everywhere, even people I love, want to silo country music into its own narrow thing. So when country music is born, the big bang of country music is at a time when a guy named Ralph Peer, in the summer of 1927 in Bristol, Tennessee, Virginia, that is to say Main Street, or the main street of it, is one side is Virginia, one side is Tennessee. He's on the Tennessee side. He records, you know, within a week, the Carter Family and Jimmy Rogers. That's the big bang. So if you listen to the Carter Family, they're like Sunday morning. They're the home, family, church values. They're wonderful. Mother Maybelle is one of the great guitarists of all times. Sarah Carter has this keening voice. AP wanders around Appalachia collecting songs with a black man. They take an old Protestant hymn that a black minister has reworked called When the World's on Fire. They turn it into their big hit, Little Darlin' Pal of Mine, which Woody Guthrie turns into This Land is Your Land. Okay, so, you know, it's kind of folky and it's got this sense of Sunday morning. Jimmy Rogers is a scamp, a rogue. He brings the blues and also training from African Americans on the railroad yards. And he brings another kind of music. They're so night and day. He's Saturday night. They're Sunday morning. So it's never been one thing, to which they then appended every other musical form at some point or another. If at the end of Johnny Cash's life, he's working with, you know, with a Trent Reznor tune, then you know that country music is sort of omnivorous, and they take cowboy stuff, and they have their own honky-tonk versions. They're one of the parents of rock and roll. They're connected to jazz. If you listen to Willie Nelson's phrasing, there's nothing about country in his phrasing. It's all Django Reinhardt. It's all jazz music. And Chet Atkins, one of the great session guitarists and later one of the great producers, all jazz influence stuff. It's never one thing. And the fact that somebody has walked into country music that is not of the color that people presume the people of country music are and just said, I'm home. That is great. That is so underrated. This is where we need to go. Country music is telling stories that all of us experience, like the joy of birth, the sadness of death, falling in love, trying to stay in love, losing love, being lonely, missing somebody, seeking redemption. Like every country song is that. We can't deal with the four-letter words that country music is about: pain, hurt, and love. And so we say, oh, it's about pickup trucks, it's about hound dogs and you know, six packs of beer. And it's not. Hank Williams said, you hear that lonesome whippoorwill, he sounds too blue to fly, the midnight train is wailing on, I'm so lonesome I could cry. Johnny Cash has a song called I Still Miss Someone. It's second verse, so simple, it's like haiku. I go out to a party to have a little fun, but I find a darkened corner because I still miss someone. When Ray Charles had creative control of an album for the first time in a distinguished, now more than 10-year career as a superstar in R&B, soul music, whatever you want to call it. When he has creative control, do you know what the album is he releases? Modern Sounds in Country and Western Music. And the summer of 62, the number one hit was I Can't Stop Loving You, an old country music song by Don Gibson. Everybody listens to other music. And the idea that we would create musical borders is just commerce's superimposition, or maybe our desire to categorize something so we don't have to know it.